I've prepared several programs and I've uploaded them to LMS. Dictionaries 1, 2, and 3, the program names are. And using these programs, I will explain to you many delicate features of the dictionaries. Dictionary is a collection of key value pairs. In a dictionary, unlike the lists or tuples, there is not only values in the dictionary, but there are also keys in the dictionary. And every dictionary item or every dictionary element is a key value pair. All keys in a dictionary must be unique. This is the most important feature of a dictionary. The keys in a dictionary must be unique, but the same values may happen many times, okay? The values may be duplicated, but the keys cannot be duplicated. In a dictionary is created using curly braces. We open a curly brace, put dictionary elements in it, and we close curly brace. Or we can create an empty dictionary by just opening and closing curly brace. We can also use the dict function to create an empty dictionary. Usually, we create an empty dictionary and later on we put values in a dictionary. But in some cases, we can directly create a dictionary with key and value pairs as we see here. Now let's look to our programs. Here on line 8, we have an empty dictionary created. The name of the dictionary is D1. And then using a key in square brackets and a value assigned to that element, we create elements or we create items. Here we are creating a key value pair in which key is 6 and value is anakara. Okay. So using this kind of assignment, we can create new elements or add new element to a dictionary. Here on the next line, we have a new element, another element is added, and a third element is added on line 11, and on line 12, a fourth element is added. Now, when we print these, let's run this program. When we print this dictionary, we see this output, okay? Anakara, Antalya, Istanbul, and Izmir, with the keys as 6, 7, 34, and 35. As we see, the key and the value are joined or separated by a column. And the items, the first item and the second item, or the first element and the second element, and the third element, the elements are separated by a comma. We could create a dictionary like we see on line 17 and 18. We can just say D2 is equal to 1 Adana, 2, 6 Ankara, blah, blah, blah. Okay. We can have here our elements, key value pairs. And of course, as I said before, key is followed by a colon, followed by a value. Then this element is, after defining this element, we write a colon, a comma, and after comma, we can put the second element, okay? Second element, and after a comma, a third element, etc. Here, we have on line 14, D1, 6 is equal to Ankara. It is very similar to statement on line 9. On line 9, there was no element in the dictionary D1 with the key 6. So this D16 is equal to Anakara has created a new element in the dictionary. But here, when we come to line 16, line 14, now in D1, we have an element with key equal to 6. So D16 is equal to Ankara does not create a new element. It updates the element with key 6. So Anakara is replaced with Ankara, okay? Here we use the same notation D16 is equal to something or D16 is equal to something on line 9 and on line 14. But the difference is that on line 9, before the line 9, there was no element with key is equal to 6. But when we come to line 14, at this point, we have already an element in the dictionary D1 with the key is equal to 6. So this does not create a new element. This updates the element with the key equal 6. So Anakara is replaced with Ankara. Okay. So when we print D1 on line 13, we have this first line. We see that 6 is Anakara, 7 Antalya, 34 Istanbul, etc. But when we print on line 15, we see that Anakara is replaced with Ankara, and we have now this dictionary. One thing about the dictionary is that not only the keys must be unique, but the keys must be either an int value, float value, string, or boolean. There cannot be any list or tuple or any other complicated thing as key. The keys must be simple, like int, float, string, or boolean. But the values can be int, float, string, boolean, complex, number, list. A list can be in values, a tuple, or dictionary. And we will see some examples about these. Let's look here. We have here months. One dictionary is declared. The keys here are again numbers, and the values are strings. And we will see some other examples in which the keys are strings and the values may be numbers. We will see these in a few minutes. Here we create a dictionary with the month numbers as keys and month names as values, okay? So when we print this, we get this output. 1 to 1 February, Jan 8, August, 12th, December, etc. When we want to access a specific element, what do we do? We use indexing. Here we have seen that we had used indexing. Through indexing, as index, we of course give the key. We use the key as index. D1 with key 6 is equal to Ankara is an assignment, but I could perfectly do a print, for example, months with key 7, print the months 1 element, the value of the months 1 element with key 7, which will print here on the output July or Jul, okay, the abbreviation of the July. Since the value corresponding to key 7 is the string with JUL, then when we say months with key 7, this gives us a value, okay? When we use indexing, we get a value. Here we are printing the elements of the months 1 dictionary. We print all of them. When we use a for loop and with the in operator in the for loop, what it does, it takes every key from this dictionary and put into M and repeats the loop. So months 1 has keys 1, 2, 3, up to 12. Therefore, and there are 12 elements. Therefore, here in this for loop on line 27 and 28, M will get values 1, 2, 3, up to 12. And each time we repeat this. So here what we are doing, we are printing on 2 columns the value of M, which is the keys of months 1, 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. And we also print next to it as a string months and with index M or with key M. Okay. So what we are doing, we are printing the key and the value. Here M is the key, because in for loops, when you use for loop with a dictionary after in operator, then it takes the keys. Therefore, M is now the individual keys of the elements of the dictionary. And in order, M is the keys, and months 1 M are the values associated with that key in the dictionary. By the way, the dictionaries, it is in Python, these structures are called dictionaries. There are very similar structures in some other languages, and sometimes they are called associative arrays. Okay, associative array. They in other programming languages they use associative arrays instead of dictionaries. Dictionary word is used for Python language, but very similar structures are called as associative arrays in other languages. Now let's come to our example here. We can iterate through the elements of a dictionary using the items method. Here we have months one dot items. What does this do? Oops, sorry. This, when we do this in our for loop, then we have to use two things, because months one is a dictionary, and when we get the items from the months one, the items consist of key and value pairs. So we months.items iteration will give us two values, the key and the value of each element. So M and D will be at the beginning, the first key and the first value, and then they will be in the loop. In the next cycle in the loop, they will be the second key and the second value, then the third key and the third value, etc., until the end of the dictionary. So it will be at the beginning, M will be 1, D will be Jean. And then next time, M will be 2, D will be Fab. Next time, M will be 3, and D will be Mar, etc. So when we print this, we see that it exactly produces the same output, okay? Here, the second time, it is printed with the loop on line 29 and 30, and the first they were printed with loop in 27 and 28, and as we see, they are identical. So either you can use this one or that one. Okay, so there are two possibilities of getting all the keys and values in one. We have only the name of the dictionary in the for loop, and we get the keys. And in order to access the elements, in order to get the elements, we use the indexing method. Okay, as index, we use the key, of course. When we give the key, we get the value. And here, the key and the value are taken directly when we use the items method with the dictionary. Let me look here. There are several functions that can be used with dictionaries. The len function, like in strings or in lists or tuples, the len function gives us the number of elements, or in other words, every element, since every element consists of a key value pair, it returns the number of key value pairs in a dictionary. Max gives us the maximum key. You have to be careful, because when we use max with a list or tuple, it gives us the maximum value in the list or in the tuple. But max with the dictionary does not give us the maximum value. It gives us the maximum key, okay? This is the main difference of using the max function with dictionaries. It gives us the maximum key. And min function gives us the minimum key. And sum function gives us the sum of the keys. Usually this is not very useful. The sum function is not very useful, but anyway, if you want to use it, it gives you not the sum of the values, it gives the sum of the keys. And sorted function returns a copy of the keys which are sorted in ascending order. I will show you there are some examples that illustrates these functions. And we have some methods. First of all, we will see the keys method. If you want to get only the keys from a dictionary, then you can use dictionary name dot keys method call, and then it will return an immutable object which contains all the keys of D in the order they are appearing in the they are existing in the dictionary. And if I'm interested in only the values, I can get only the values from a dictionary by calling the values method. D.values gives us only the values in a dictionary. The copy method, like in strings or in lists and tuples, gives us a copy of a dictionary of the dictionary before the dot copy. I'll come to this update. Let's see some, or maybe I will continue and then I will show all the examples together. If I have two lists and I want to update the first list with the elements of the second list, what do I do? If I have two dictionaries and if I want to update a dictionary one with the elements of dictionary two, then I use the update method. D1.update and inside parenthesis D2 will take the elements of D2, which consists of, again, key and value pairs, and checks if they exist in D1. If they exist in D1, then D2 elements will be added. If in the parameter, let's call this D2, there are some elements with the same keys as in D1, then those will be updated. Okay, I will show you an example about that. Maybe I can directly show it somewhere here. For example, let's look here. I have D1. This one is D1. One Adana, six Ankara, seven Antalya, and my D2 is this one, and here all the keys are different than the keys in D1. So D1 update D2 will just add those 31 Hatay, 34 Istanbul, 35 Izmir, and 48 Mexico to D1. D1 will have, it had originally three elements, and four new elements came from here with four new keys. So D1 has seven elements after this D1.update. But here we have again D1 update, and instead of D2, we can just copy this, the whole thing, and put instead of D2, we can copy this and put here, okay? It is similar, it is the same thing. Here we update again the D1. This time we have 48 Muğla, 77 Yalova. But now D1 contains the key 48. It doesn't contain 77. Since it contains 48, and with 48 the value was Mexico, what will happen? D1.update will change the element with key 48 because it exists already in the dictionary, and the value will be changed to Muğla, and 77 doesn't exist as a key in the dictionary D1, therefore the 77 and Yalova will be added to the dictionary D1. So here in one D1.update method call, we are both updating an element because the key exists, and we are adding a new element because the key doesn't exist. We could have, of course, other things. 8, I don't know where 8 is. Okay, so here one element is updated and two elements are changed. Or I can here, for example, here 34, and let's put here some other string. Then in this case, what will happen? 48 exists, Mexico is changed with Muğla. 77 doesn't exist, 77 and Yalova are added. 34 exists, So Istanbul is replaced with WEF, and 80 doesn't exist. This is added. Okay. So in one update, we just update the dictionary with the key value pairs here. If the keys doesn't exist, they are added. If the keys exist, then those elements are updated. Okay. Let's remove this to make it as before. Let's go back to our lecture notes. I have shown you items. With items, you can create loops in which you can get the key and value together. Be careful, there is a comma between the key and value variables. I use here two variables. I can use either key or value or some other variables, A and B or whatever, but they have to be separated by a comma. And then in the loop, I can use those variables. Get method is an interesting method. It may be at the beginning a bit difficult to understand. What it does is like that. Assume that DD is a dictionary, okay? A dictionary that contains some elements. When we have dd.getk, x, the get method has two parameters. One parameter for the key and one parameter for value. If this key exists in D, it gives us the value of that element, okay? It doesn't use this value, it uses the value of the element with the key, which is equal to the given key, okay? If the key doesn't exist in D, then in this case, this returns back to us the value. It is similar to this. If K exists in D, in DD, then the value of A or this method call gives us that element, okay? The value of that element. If key K exists, this exists, okay? So K exists in the DD, then we get its value. So this gives us its value. If K doesn't exist in DD, if this K do not exist in DD, then this method call gives us X. Otherwise, if K is not in DD, then we get X from dd.getkx, okay? The result of this either is ddk or x, depending on the existence of k in dictionary dd. So instead of writing four lines, we can write only one line, and this is frequently done in many applications. We will see some applications that we use this, and it will make our program shorter. There are several more methods. Pop item method removes the last key value pair from the dictionary. Any element, any key value pair that is added to the dictionary by using this notation, D index key equal value. If the key doesn't exist, it is added to the end of the dictionary, okay? And in this case, dpop item removes the last inserted element, the last inserted key value pair. If we want to remove a specific element, then we use the pop method. And with pop method, we use the key. The element with this key will be removed from the dictionary. We can also remove, you can use either this one or this one. These two are identical. We can delete an element of a dictionary given a key using del and then space, the dictionary name and the key as index, okay? So this specifies an element, and del deletes it from the dictionary. So there are two ways of deleting an element, either dictionary name dot pop with the key that is wanted to be deleted, and or the del and dictionary name and the key as index. If we want to remove all elements, then we use the clear method. Now let's see in our program the illustrations of these. Where we have left, we have we were here. I will come to this later on. Here, let's see our examples. We have seen this, the items I explained this to you. Now let's go here. We can create elements using loops. Here we create an empty dictionary. Either we can use dict function call with no parameter or just curly braces. Okay, both are same. Either I can initialize and create an empty dictionary using open and close curly braces, or by just calling the dict function with no parameter. They are identical. And then here I built a loop for k in range 1, 11. As we know perfectly now, range 1, 11 will create values from 1 to 10. 1 is inclusive, it starts with 1, but 11 is exclusive. So this for loop will create those values 1 to 10, and they will be assigned to k, and the loop will be repeated. So k will be 1 at the beginning, then 2, then 3, and then at the end it will be 10. What do we have here? Squares, we use the value of key, k, as the key of the dictionary. Squares is a dictionary now. And what we do here, we multiply k by k, or in other words, we just take the power of 2 of k. K asterisk asterisk 2 takes the square of k, or we can say this, they are both gives the same result, k multiplied by k, which is the square of k. And therefore, an element is created with value of k and its square as value. Okay, the key, k, the value of k is the key. 1 is key, then 2, and then 3 and 4 are keys. These are the key. These becomes the key because it is in the square brackets as index. And the values are their square. So when we run this, we obtain that dictionary. 6 is the key, for example, it's square 36. 7 is the key, square 49 is the value. 8 and 64, 9 and 81, and 110 and 100 are the key value pairs in this example. Here we have a dictionary with lists instead of values. Here again we have numeric keys 1, 2, 3, but the values are now not single elements but lists. So this dictionary has integer keys 1, 2, 3, but the values are lists. When we print them, we can, when we use just print function to print it, we get something like this. But if the question says print the every element on a different line with one space between the key and the value, Sorry, my internet connection was broken again. I hope you hear me right now.
We can hear you, teacher.
Okay.
Let's continue with our example. Here we have a dictionary in which the values are lists. How do we access the, when we print them using this for loop on line 46 and 47, we get this output, okay, on right hand side. But in order to access individual elements of the lists in the dictionary, what do we do? Now we have, we use indexing twice. The first index is the index of the dictionary. So months to M refers to a single list. Months to M, months to 5 is, for example, this May and 31. Months to 8 is August 31. It is this one. But in order to get access, in order to access the individual values in the lists, we have to use a second index. The second index corresponds to the index of the individual items or elements in the list. Months M is the list. Months M0 is its first element. Months M1 is its second element. So we can get the month name and the number of days using the indexes 0 and 1 for the specific list. Okay, months M gives us one list, one of those lists, either this one or that one or whatever, and we can access the either month name or the day, number of days, using index 0 and index 1 inside that list. Okay, so here in the second loop here, to print the months to list, since the months to dictionary, we have again for M in months to, we have this. M is the key, which is 1 to 12. Months M is the list. 0 is the first element in the list, which is month name. And months M is the list. And months M1 is the second element in the list, which is number of days in that month. Here, I want to change, assume that we are in a leap year, and I want to change the 28 days for February to 29. How do I do that? The key is 2, okay? Since the key is 2, when I use months with key 2, I access this list, and I want to change the second element, which is index 1. So months to 1 is equal to 29, and when I print the months once more, I will see that for the February, the number of days is changed to 29 from 28. Okay, so we can access the individual elements of the list values, because here the lists are values of the items in the dictionary, and we can change those. Since the lists are mutable, are changeable, we can change those elements. If here, instead of lists, I put tuples, it is possible. Just inside this months to declaration, change all the square brackets with parentheses, then it will be a dictionary made up of tuples as values. In that case, of course, I cannot change them, okay? If I want to have something that are not changeable in a dictionary, then I can use tuples in a dictionary. But this can be only used in values. In the keys, I can either use int or a number or a string or boolean. Boolean is not used much, but anyway, it may sometimes may be used, but usually either a number or a string are used as the keys of the dictionaries. I will I'm looking if I have any example in which I have strings as keys. In another example, I will show it to you. Let me check here. We will have something like that in the next example. So here we have a loop in which we start with an empty dictionary, and we use a loop. Here we have for j in range 10. Therefore, j will get the values from 0 to 9. This will repeat the loop 10 times. We are not using j inside the loop. We are using this for loop just to repeat a task 10 times. So these three lines will be repeated 10 times. Here we call the randint method of the random class. As you know, random.randint gets two parameters. If you give two parameters, then it generates an integer number between these two, both inclusive. It can be 20, it can be 40, or it can be any number between, any integer number between 20 and 40. Okay. And random.randint will generate, here in this example, the parameters are 1 and 100. It will generate a value between 1 and 100, both inclusive, and therefore the value of V will be something like that, 1 to 100. But K will be 20 to 40. So we generate two numbers, and here we have RD, K, RD is R, the random dictionary, random, R for random, dictionary for D, that's why I use RD word, RD variable name. RD K is equal to V. If K does not exist in RD dictionary, then this will add a new element. If K is already generated, because here in a loop, we generate random values between for K between 20 and 40. If the same value had already been generated in this loop before, therefore the RD dictionary would have a key with the same value, but probably V will be different. And then in that case, it will update that same element. So when we run it, we get something like that. At the end, we print the dictionary on 63, and here we see that this is our dictionary. Let me run once more. Here, 29 and 63. Therefore, the first time K was 29 and most probably V was 63. This is created. The next time K was 30, V was 29. Next time K was 31, blah, blah, etc. Okay, so here we are. We have some elements which are created. Now, when we use, here it is. Here we are. Number of elements, there are 9 elements here. When we print the number of elements with len function, we see that there are only 9 elements. It means that once in the loop, since the loop repeated 10 times, once in the loop, a value of K was equal to a previous K. Okay, K repeated in the loop twice. So it just updated an element instead of adding new element. That's why instead of 10 elements, we have only 9 elements. Anyway, it's not important. Assume that we have this dictionary, which has 9 elements. Now, if we use operator in an if statement, if something, either a value or a variable or whatever, in RD, what it does, it checks if in the dictionary this value exists as a key. If 24 in RD, if this is true, it will mean that key 24 exists in dictionary. If this is false, then it means that RD does not have any key which is equal to 24. So key 24 does not exist in dictionary D. here it says that it doesn't exist. In operator in for, here we have in operator in if statement, in which case we have a variable or a value and a dictionary. It checks the existence of that key in the dictionary. But if we use in operator with for loop, in a for loop, then it takes every key from RD, puts into the variable, and repeats the loop. Of course, it is not possible to write here 24. We will get some error to here. In for loop, we have to put here a variable name. We have seen this. I've explained this already. Now, max function and min function, sum function, and sorted. As I said a few minutes ago, max function returns the maximum key in a this dictionary. So here we have 29, 30, 30, 25, 30, 28, etc. Here is our dictionary. And when they are printed on different lines, here they are printed in two different ways. Anyway, what is the maximum key? It is, by chance, at the end, it is 39. Okay. What is the minimum key? It is 20. Let's run this once more so that it will not be by chance at the end. It's again at the end. Once more. Come on.
Excuse me.
Yes.
Maximum and minimum functions just for integers or also string characters maybe?
Yes. It will also return the maximum and minimum string key as well. It's not only for numbers, it also works for string keys, okay?
Okay, thank
Let's
you.
Do an example, a quick example here. Since you asked this, let's create a quick example. Let's put here, for example, mm is equal to, let's create a dictionary here with, for example, January 31. February 28, March, for example. Now, this time, I'm using strings as keys and numbers as values, okay? The first thing is before the colon is the key. So, keys are Jan, Feb, March, 31. And let's put here August, because it starts with A, it will be smaller than the rest, 31. And let's put here December, 31 again. And let's put in the meantime, something like September, which is 30. Okay. Now, if I go and print max of mm, and then let's print the min of mm on the same line, and we will have this Sep and August. Okay, why Sep starts with S? It is greater than all other keys. It is greater than Jan, Feb, Mar, August, Sep. It starts with S. Okay, and Aug starts with A, which is the minimum inside the keys, okay? So when I print max and min here, I print sep and O. Is it okay?
Yes, çok, thank you.
You are welcome. So max and min methods not only works for number keys, but they also work for string keys. But the sum function only work for number keys, okay? It gives us the number, the sum of the number keys. If the keys are string, then if I try to, for example, print sum of mm, then I will get an error message, as you see. Okay, because the keys here are not numbers; they are strings. So the sum function doesn't work for dictionaries which has string keys. sorted gives us an entity which a list contains the keys which are in sorted order. And when we run this, we will see that here we have the keys in this. This is our dictionary 2022. This is sorted where it is unsorted. I'm looking for unsorted. No, it's not sorted. There is 24 to 23. Okay. So here, this is our dictionary content. 20 key, 86 is the value, 22 is key, 72 is value, etc. And here we have the output of the line 87 sorted RD, in which we see that the keys 20, 22, 23, 24, 25, 20, 31, 37 are all sorted ascendingly. They are in ascending order.
Bir şey sorabilir miyim?
Evet.
Hocam hani az önce sum fonksiyonu çalışmaz dediniz ya. Peki mesela 90. satırdaki MM'in başına mı int komutunu eklemeliyiz, yoksa her bir aydan sonra tek tek eklememiz mi gerekiyor? Çünkü hani January, February'leri de integer'a çevirmemesi için. Yani sadece gün, ayların günlerini toplayacak olsak.
Yani you mean the, to sum, to find the sum of values. The sum function returns the sum of the keys, okay? It has nothing to do with values. If you want to find the sum of the values, then in one of my programs, I might have asked this somewhere here. Find how we can get the sum of the values. It is easy. As I explained a few minutes ago to you, if I use values method, I get only the values, okay? So how can I find the sum of the values? Let's write here. Here, with the sum of the keys is taken by sum. If I want to get sum of the sum of the values, let's copy these two lines and put here them. Sum of values. How do I get sum of values? It is again easy. We have here sum of not RD, but RD dot get values. Sorry, I did not get values. I did that values gives us the RD dot values gives us only the values. Okay. If I give only the values to sum function, then I get the sum of the values. Okay.
Teşekkür ederim hocam.
You're welcome. So the values function can be the values, sorry, not function, the values method. What is the difference between a method and a function? A method is always requires an object to use, okay? And the dictionary object dot keys, dictionary object dot values, dictionary object dot copy, dictionary object dot update, okay? There is always an object when we call a method. Before the method, there is an object name and then the dot operator and the method name. But in functions, it's not like that. We don't have any object preceding the function names. That's why they are called functions. But these are called methods because they are always, the methods are always preceded by an object and the dot operator between object and the method name. Okay. This is the main difference between functions. Sometimes some functions, function is similar to the some function of the met, some the function of some methods. The operation may be similar, but there is a main difference in their usage. In functions, we just call the function with some parameters. Of course, some methods may have parameters. For example, get method has two parameters, pop method has one parameter, etc. But anyway, when we use a method, it is always used with an object before the method call. But method name is preceded with an object, okay? the computer science students will get other courses, and most engineering students will get Java as well next semester. And next semester I will be teaching Java to you, and you will see that in there the methods are very frequently used, and then always we will have some objects and some methods together, and we will, you will be able to learn how to use methods better in next semester. Anyway, let's continue with this, with our example. Here we had, for example, I'm only interested in keys. Then what I can do, for example, in this loop, I have for x in rd.keys. rd.keys gives me only the keys of the dictionary rd. So here in this loop, I can only use the keys. Similarly, if I'm only interested in values, then what I can have a similar loop to this one. Let's say, for example, let's copy this, control C. Here we have values. Let's write here rd.values. Then in this loop, on line 120 and 121, since we are using the values of the dictionary, we cannot have any access to keys. In this loop, the x is the values. Here we are only printing the values of the dictionary in the same order they occur, they exist in the dictionary. Here we are printing the keys on in the loop 114 and 115, but in this loop 120 and 121, we are only printing the values, individual values on each on a different line. Here, for example, we want to get the average values. Our question can be, write a function that gets a dictionary as parameter. We give a dictionary, D, assume that the dictionary parameter is D in this example. Write a function that gets a dictionary as parameter and returns the average of its values, of the values that exist in the dictionary. How we will do it? Here, we will have a for loop in which it will get the values of the dictionary. D.values gives us only the values, and in this for loop we get each of them separately in the variable v, and we add them to v sum. We initialize, of course, v sum to zero. When this loop is finished, we would be adding all the values of the dictionary to v sum, and here when we divide v sum by the number of elements in the dictionary d, len d gives us the number of elements or the number of values, key value pairs, then we would find the average. Okay, so return here returns the result of this expression, which is v sum divided by the number of elements in D. This is, of course, the average. So this function aware values will give us the average of the values. Assume that we have another variable. We have our dictionary RD that we have created before. Assume that we are still using this. And aware of RD is equal to aware values, and we pass RD dictionary as a parameter, and our values will get that dictionary, will find the average of the values and return the average of the values, and the average of the values of the RD is assigned to our D, and then we are printing our D. Here, what is where it is? Sorted function. Here sorted function. Okay, sorted, as I said, gives us the keys on it. Only gets the keys and sorts the keys and gives us a new list that consists of the keys. Let's look here, sorted function. Here is our dictionary, 33, 86, 31, 22, 21, 12, blah, blah. This is our main dictionary, okay? This is our RD. Now, using this dictionary, when we call the sorted RD, it will get 33, 31, 21, 39, etc. Only the keys, and it will sort them and gives us in a list. So here, as we see, when we sort, we get the sorted RD is assigned to KS, and when we print KS, we see that it is a list in which the keys of the dictionary are sorted in ascending order. And I want to print the elements of the dictionary in the key order. Inside, it doesn't exist in the key order. The first key is 33, then 31, then 22, then 31, then 21, then 39, etc. They are in mixed order. But I want to print key value pairs in increasing order. So what I do, I use KS. Since the values of KS are also the keys of the RD dictionary, then when we use for K in KS, we get all the values in KS into K, but the values of KS are the keys of the RD, okay? Because KS is equal to sorted RD, which gets the keys of RD in ascending order, puts into KS. So the elements or the values of KS are the keys of RD. So when we get all the elements of KS using a for loop, those keys are also the keys of the RD dictionary. Okay. So when we print this, we print the keys are keys and RDK are the values in the dictionary. So we can print here the dictionary using our KS list. Instead of using KS list, just since KS is equal to sorted RD, what I can do, I can delete KS and instead put sorted RD, the result will be same. Of course, I've changed a little bit. Instead of putting K equal, value equal, etc., I just printed them like this, but the values are same. If you look here, and if you look to the next one, 20, 38, 21, 13, 25, 79, etc., they are all same values, okay? The first column are keys, the second column are values. We have seen keys, values in much more detail. Do we have 10 minutes time? Although we have finished, we have come to 3 o'clock. Do you have any other lecture after this?
At 3:30.
Okay, then I will continue for another 10-15 minutes because there are some important things that I want to explain to you. Here, I will skip this one. I will go to the next one. This is quite important. So I will explain this and finish today's lecture. If by chance we cannot do a lecture tomorrow, I want you to know this subject. How can we use dictionaries as counters? Assume that we have a list which contains some names. Jane, Raquel, Kemal, Raquel, Raquel, Albert, Jane. These names are, or the values of this list are the votes for some candidates. Assume that we have several candidates. Jane, Raquel, Kemal, and Albert are candidates, and people have voted for them. The first vote is for Jane, the second vote is for Raquel, the third vote is for Kemal, the next vote is for Raquel, another vote for Raquel, another vote for Albert, another vote for Jane, etc. These are votes, okay? People have voted for candidates. And from here, we want to know who has got how many votes, okay? When we print these votes, let's run this. This is our dictionary, okay? This is our list. We have a list of votes. Okay. Which each vote is added to the list, and at the end our list is this. Now, using this list, I want to find how many votes Jane got, how many votes Rockwell got, how many votes Kemal got, and how many votes Albert got. Okay. This is, I'm interested in this. Now, first of all, let me remove some of the values. Okay, let's remove one of them. Now, we have only one winner, Rockwell. I will change and show it later on. Now, how can I process this list to find who got how many votes? What I do, I create an empty dictionary. And each time when I get a name from votes, I just check if this exists as a key in the counts. If it doesn't exist in the counts dictionary, then we will create a key value pair in which the key will be the name of the candidate. It will be Jane, for example. And since it is the first occurrence, then the value will be one. So at the end, we will create a dictionary similar to this one. Okay. On the right hand side, you see on the right hand side, we will have, since in this list there are four unique names, the number of unique names in this list is four. There are Jane, votes for Jane, votes for Rockwell, votes for Kemal, and votes for Albert. These are the unique values. We will have a dictionary that contains those unique names, and as value, it will be how many times that name exists in the list. Okay. How can we do this? We can do this with a for loop. We initialize our dictionary. It is empty at the beginning. We don't know if there are two candidates, three candidates, five candidates, or 10 candidates. We don't know the number of candidates. As long as there are new candidates, we will add in the dictionary and we will update the counts. Now, in our loop, this is for name for in votes. We get all the values in the votes list and put into the name. Name will be at the beginning Jane, then Rockwell, then Kemal, then Rockwell, etc. And for each name, if the name occurs as a key in counts, as I explained a few minutes ago, when we use with if a variable name or value in a dictionary, what it does, it checks if this value, if this thing name exists as a key in the dictionary. So if there is a key with this name, with Jane or Rockwell or Kemal in the counts dictionary, what do? We get one more name from the votes in the loop. So what we will do, we will increment its votes count. Okay. Plus equal one, we will increment it. Jane, if Jane was, for example, 3, and if find another Jane here, then what we will do, we will increment 3 to 4. When we find another Jane, we will increment from 4 to 5. So the value of the dictionary for that name will be increased by 1 if the name exists in the counts dictionary. If the name does not exist in the count dictionary, for example, when we come to here, Kemal, the dictionary contains already Jane, already Rockwell. When we come to the third element in the for loop here, Kemal does not exist in the dictionary. So what will happen if Kemal in counts, is counts has a key named Kemal? No. We'll go to else, counts Kemal equal to 1. This is the first vote for Kemal, okay? It will create a new element in the dictionary because name in counts doesn't exist. When it comes to else, if it comes to else, it means that name does not exist as a key in counts dictionary. Therefore, counts and the key equals something will create a new element. Do we agree on that? If the name does not exist, it will go to the else part. And here, since the key doesn't exist, as I said at the beginning of the lecture, if we use the key as indexed in a dictionary, which does not exist, then it adds a new key value pair with this key and with the value which is assigned to it. Therefore, it will create a new element, for example, Kemal and one. And when it comes and finds Kemal once more, this time Kemal in counts will be true. What it will do, it will plus equal one to value of Kemal. So the Kemal's vote will be increased by one. Is this now understood, this for loop? When this for loop finishes and when we print that, we will get this output. This dictionary will be created after the loop at 14 has finished. We can print this in a different way. Name in counts, name and counts name. Name is the keys, counts name is the value, and we can print them like this. We can also, instead of doing this with those five statements, line 14 to line 18, we can do the same thing on two lines only. For name in votes, again, the same loop. The loop is same here and here is same. But now inside, instead of having if name in counts increase by one, else just assign one, what do we do? Count name, this time I use cnt, instead of counts, I use cnt, not to mix with the other one. Okay. Cnt name, here counts name, it's the same thing. But after that, it is different. What do we have here? cnt.get name, comma zero, and then outside there is plus one. What does this mean? Now assume that we have, for example, again, getting Kemal. At the third vote is Kemal. Kemal does not exist in the dictionary. What will happen? It will check here, count get name. Kemal does exist? No. If it doesn't exist, what get method gives us? It gives us the second parameter. Okay. So since Kemal does not exist, cnt.get Kemal, comma zero will give us zero. Zero plus one is one. And since Kemal doesn't exist, cnt Kemal will create a new element. And since the value here is one, it will be the first vote for Kemal and it will be one. And when we come and find Kemal once more, here we have another Kemal. What will happen? cnt Kemal, again, the same. On the left-hand side, we have again cnt Kemal, but since we have an assignment, in assignments, first the right part is executed, a result is found, and then it is assigned to the element on the left-hand side. So what we have here, cnt get Kemal. Now Kemal exists in the list. And what is the value with that? There is only one Kemal here. So when we come to the second Kemal, the value is one. So cnt.get Kemal, comma zero will give us one because an element with key equal to Kemal exists and its value is one. So what will be? We will get here one. One plus one, two. So the new value of cnt Kemal will be two. When we come to the third Kemal, now cnt.get Kemal will give us two plus one, three. It will increase by one. So these four lines, for lines 14 to 18, can be replaced with lines 29 and 30. They do the same thing. Of course, I just changed the name because I don't want to mix them. But if I change the cnt to counts, then it will be exactly the same. I wanted to illustrate it. That's why I've written like that. If I print cnt, when we print cnt, we see that this is cnt, and this is counts, and they are exactly same. Now I want to find who is the winner or who are the winners. There may be two winners, or there may be only or three winners, or if there are 10 candidates, it may be by chance three or four candidates may get the maximum votes altogether, equal votes, and some others may get less votes, but or maybe only one person gets the highest votes. Here in this case we have Jane got 6 votes, Raquel 7 votes, Kemal 6 votes, and Albert 3 votes, and Raquel is the winner. How do we find it? Here, what we make, we get the values, okay? And we put in either a tuple or list, it doesn't matter. What we could do, it is a bit easier, if we take these values. Okay, first of all, VTS is equal to tuple values, and let's print this VTS. Let's see the result. Here is our VTS, okay? We get the values from the dictionary converted to a tuple. So we get this. If instead of converting to a tuple, if we convert it to a list, we can put here the list function, list between parentheses, we have cnt.values. Cnt is this dictionary, okay? This is our dictionary. cnt.values just gets the values which are 6, 7, 6, and 3. And when we run this, we will see that now it is not a tuple, but it's a list. And we want to get the maximum of it. So instead of doing in two steps, what we can do, we can just take this completely and put here, okay? Already VTS is equal to this, so what I have must, max, list, CNT values. CNT values just gives us something which only contains values. We convert those values to a list. We put in a list, and we get the maximum of that list. So here, with this statement, we get the maximum of the values, which is in this case 7. And then we will find who got the maximum values. Here, what we do, we again for name in CNT. Remember, CNT is our result dictionary, which contains the names and the number of votes for each candidate. And here, for name in CNT, we'll take the keys. The keys are Jane, Raquel, Kemal, and Albert. So name will be Jane or Raquel or Kemal or Albert in the loop. For what we do, we check if CNT name, which is the value, the vote 6 or 7 or 6 or 3, is equal to maximum vote. Okay, then we print its name and the vote. Let's put here one more Kemal. Kemal had got 6. Let's make Kemal's votes or are also 7. Let's run this. Now Kemal, Raquel has 6 votes, 7 votes, and Raquel, Kemal has 7 votes. Okay. So when we look here, persons with max votes have printed now 2 lines, because there are 2 people whose value, or in this count dictionary, there are 2 elements which has maximum values, Raquel 7 and Kemal 7. Since here we check if the value with key, which is equal to name, is equal to the max number of votes, then print the name and the max number of votes, which is the value of the vote anyway. So we print here 2 lines. What happens if you just try to get max like this? Yeah. I'll show it to you. It also works. We don't need to convert. Yes?
We have class. We have class soon.
Okay, I'm finishing in 1 or 2 minutes, okay? I'll finish in 2 minutes time. Here, we have taken the values only, converted to a list, put in a list, and get the max. Or we can directly use the max function with only the values, okay? Instead of putting into a list and then getting the max from list, since this contains only the values, I can just use max and cnt values. When we run it, we don't get any error. As you see, it works. And max v2 is used here anyway. So we can either use max list count values to get the maximum value in a list, or we can just say max and count values to get the maximum value. Max v and max v2 will have the same values. Okay, I'm finishing. Do you have any questions?
No, don't hear.
Hocam, okay. Ben bir dersten alakası bir şey